Has he thought it through what happens then? Mr. President, has anyone thought that what happens when there is a bloodbath? What do you think the impact will have on people of Kashmir? What do you think they will think the way they have been boxed in their houses, treated like worse than animals, no rights? Thousands of all the political leadership has been arrested, taken out of Kashmir. Even those Kashmiri leaders who were pro-India have been taken out. 13,000 boys have been picked up and taken to God knows which destinations. So what do they think? What will the people of Kashmir do when they lift the curfew? They will be out in the streets. And what will these soldiers do? They will shoot them. They've already used pellet guns, blinded young boys. In the last 6 years, the 5 years, the oppression that has gone on in Kashmir. And so, Kashmiris will be further radicalized. Mr. President, there will be another Pulwama. And guess what? India will blame us. They're already blaming us. They're saying all this is happening because of Pakistan. One of their defense ministers said there are 500 terrorists lined up on the border to go in. Why would Pakistan send 500 terrorists when there are 900,000 troops? What impact are they going to make? What will they do? And why would? Don't we know that the moment there is some terrorist attack, all that will happen is there'll be further cruelty and oppression of the people of Kashmir. We will just give the 900,000 troops to further crush the people of Kashmir. And then we'll give the Indian government an excuse that, look, Pakistan is a terrorist state, and this mantra that has gone on, Islamic terrorism. The moment you use this catchword, Islamic terrorism, the whole world turns away. No one talks about human rights. You can do whatever you want, which is what has happened in Kashmir, because they keep using this word, Islamic terrorism. And this is what they're doing right now. What do we benefit from further increasing the cruelty on the people of Kashmir? And why would we want this? But there is no other narrative left for India. As when they lift the curfew, whatever happens, Pakistan will be blamed, and there is always a danger of another Pulwama. They might come and bomb us again, and then another cycle might start. And what does Narendra Modi think that 180 million Muslims of India are thinking right now? Aren't they watching these Kashmiris stuck inside, like for 55 days they've been stuck in? Aren't they watching? What do you think? Don't you think that the Muslims will be radicalized in India? And I am talking about 180 million people. And when they get radicalized, there will be some incident in India somewhere down the line. Again, we will be blamed. And I'm warning you right now, again, we will be blamed. And Mr. President, what about 1.3 billion Muslims who are watching this? And they know that it is only happening in Kashmir because they are Kashmiri Muslims. This is not happening to Kashmiri Hindus. They know that this is happening because of their religion. So what do you think they will be thinking? What do you think the Jewish community would think if there were 8,000 Jews stuck like this? What do you think Europeans would think? What do we think? I mean, any human community, if their members are stuck like that, what do you think they will think? Are we a children of a lesser God? Is it not going to cause us pain? And then I'll tell you what will happen. People will, in the 1.3 billion Muslims, someone will pick up arms. I know
We've been brought up with
films, Western films. This good, decent guy doesn't get justice. He decides to pick up a gun and start seeking justice. There was a film made in New York, famous film called Death Wish. This guy gets mugged by his, and his family, his wife gets killed or something. He can't get justice. He picks up a gun and he goes around shooting muggers. And the whole cinema cheers him on. So what do you think the Muslims are thinking right now? If there is a bloodbath, there will be Muslims becoming radicals, not because of Islam, but because of what they will see, that there's no justice when it comes to Muslims. There were Rohingya Muslims, Myanmar, who are, God knows, almost a million people out, ethnic cleansing. What was the response of the world community? So what do you think will be the response of 1.3 billion Muslims? I picture myself. I'm in Kashmir. I've been locked up for 55 days. I have heard about, and there are rapes, Indian Army going into homes, soldiers. Would I want to live this humiliation? Would I want to live like that? I would pick up a gun. You're forcing people. You are forcing people into radicalization. When people lose the will to live, what is there to live for? And this is what, if you can do this to human beings, you are actually radicalizing people. And so, Mr. President, I want to repeat here, this is one of the most critical times. There will be a reaction to this. Pakistan will be blamed. Two nuclear armed countries will come face to face like we came in February. And before we head in that direction, the United Nations has a responsibility. This is why. This is why the United Nations came into being in 1945. You were supposed to stop this happening. I feel we are back to 1939, Munich. Czechoslovakia has been taken, annexed. What is the world community going to do? Is it going to appease a market of 1.2 billion, or is it going to stand up for justice and humanity? If this goes wrong, you hope for the best, but be prepared for the worst. If a conventional war starts between the two countries, Mr. President, if a conventional war starts, and anything could happen, but supposing a country seven times smaller than its neighbor is faced with the choice, either you surrender or you fight for your freedom till death, what will we do? I ask myself this question. And my belief is, la ilaha illallah, there is no God but one. And we will fight. And when a nuclear armed country fights to the end, it will have consequences far beyond the borders. It will have consequences for the world, which is why I repeat I'm here. Because I'm warning you, it's not a threat. It's a fear, worry. That where are we headed? And I've come here to tell the UN, you've got to, this is a test for the United Nations. You are the one who guaranteed the people of Kashmir the right of self-determination. They are suffering because of that. And this is the time not to appease like in 1939, appeasement took place. This is the time to take action. And number one action must be that India must lift this inhuman curfew, which has lasted for 55 days.